go. So always the first thing that I do when I start with a project is select everything with Control or Command A and delete. So you've got a nice clean workspace. And the first thing I would like to build with you, as I just showed you, is this XY scope thing again. So an XY scope where you take the left and the right channel of an audio file and create a visualization from it. So I do have in the InterAccess workshop folder, in media, there is in the audio folder, there's a little audio file. If you don't have an audio file yourself, you can use this. Otherwise, you can use whatever you have available. And to bring this into TouchDesigner, you can literally just drag it from the folder. So that's again the InterAccess workshop folder, media audio. Actually, I shifted some stuff around. It might be, if you haven't downloaded it or if you haven't linked to it directly, it might be in day one media. And once you have this dragged in, you should see two nodes. One is the audio file in shop, and the other one is an audio device out shop that comes in right away to listen to it. It's probably best if we, since we'll all be listening to it, you can always turn these things off by toggling the active flag in the parameters. If you don't see the parameters, you can always bring them up with the P key.
Oh,
I told you that I would bring you shortcut cards and I forgot. Damn it. Sorry. So anyway, the P key toggles the parameters and the active flag on the audio device out stops the playback completely. Okay. The other thing that I try to really make a point of is that when I have these, when I bring these nodes in and I want to work with those, it's always a good idea to have a null chop to work from. So I would add a null chop to the output of the audio file in. And just as a reminder, if I want to create a new branch here, which I want to do, I can middle mouse click onto the output. And this brings up my upgrade dialog. And then add a null. Now we have the channel data. And to convert this into 3D geometry, it's a fairly simple process. What you can do is double click somewhere in the network and go onto the SOP family and then find a CHOP2 SOP. And place that CHOP2 SOP down. And that CHOP2 SOP comes with an error. It says invalid input chop, meaning there's a chop parameter here, but we haven't filled it out yet with anything. So you want to reference this null one in this chop parameter. And you can do this by just having the parameters up for the chop two chop, and then taking the null chop and dragging it onto this chop parameter. Now it's still not quite happy. You still have a yellow flag up here. So middle mouse clicking onto the node again reveals the information and it says it cannot find these channels TX, TY, TZ that it's expecting. It has here a channel scope where these TX, TY, TZ come in, like where they're referenced. And if you look at the null chop, you see that what we actually have is a channel one and a channel two. There's no TX, TY, TZ. So what I would do here is just delete the txtytz and rename and type in channel 1, channel 2, hit enter, and I already have the geometry. Now you still get a warning. Now it tells you, oh, more attribute values than channel specified. This is because it's actually expecting a TX, TY, TZ, or channels that represent all three axes. We just have two here. So in the attribute scope, I can just remove the P2. In geometry, when you're dealing with geometry, the P attribute is always the position of in space, and P, it's a three component vector for X, Y, Z. We just have X, Y, so I'll delete the P2 and the warning is gone. Now I can already start rendering this because that's pretty much all I needed for my X, Y scope for now. And rendering in touch was this funny thing where you have to bring the sub into a geometry component. You have to kind of switch context for it to be renderable. And to do this, the quickest way to do that is by right-clicking on the output of the chop2 sub, and under the comp family in the opcreate dialog, find the geometry component. All the components that are important for rendering things can be found in the first column here. That's where you have lights, cameras, bones, and things like that. So pick the geometry component. And the other things I need for a render would be a camera. So double click in the network and find the camera, which is also in the comp family. And now theoretically, I would, for geometry to be renderable, I theoretically would need a light, because you need something, a light source, so that light is reflected and the camera can see something. What we will do though for this, because we don't have surfaces that we're rendering that could reflect light, we just have a line that we need to render. There's a material for this. So if you double click or click tab to bring up the upgrade dialog and go to the material section, there's a constant mat. And what this constant mat does is it gives every vertice of your geometry a constant color. Now we need to reference this material to the geometry. And if you don't want to bring up the parameters, and you just want to quickly reference this, you can take this material, drop it onto the Geo1 node, and a little drop-down menu comes, which tells you that there's a parameter available where this material fits onto. So you can click the Parm material item in the menu. That's pretty good. We have almost everything. Now, the last step to render this would be converting the 3D data into 2D data, and 2D data in touch is a top texture operator. So if you hit tab and go to the texture operators, you can find a render top. Just the third column all the way at the bottom, pretty much. There's a couple more, render pass and render select, which I won't be talking about. But if you place this render top down, you can see that it's actually rendering something onto your black or checkerboard background, which is now a graphic. The difference again being from, yes? Why is it, sorry? By default, when you put down a render top in the parameters, it looks already for CAM1, and for geometry and lights, it has a star in it. Star meaning just pick up any geometry that's available, pick up any lights that are available.
So what happens if you have more than one camera or more than one geometry going on?
You can, there's multiple uses there. One thing is, if you have multiple geometry that you don't want in the same render node, you can specify the geometry by just typing in the name. Same is true for the camera, but you could also have multiple cameras in one render, and then use the render select node to actually select out the render with the other camera that you're referencing. Okay. So if I would add a second camera here, and let's say I move this camera to the right and rotate it a little bit. This is going to look almost similar, but I mean, it's not really a good graphic for this. What you could now do is take a render select, reference the render, and now you have access to the second camera. To the second camera view via the same this would be something. It's way lighter to have one render and a render select. It's more it's optimized.
As opposed to having one render per camera.
Yeah. Okay. Exactly. Yeah. Let's go delete that again. And just to remember, what we're doing here is in the SOC on the left side, the CHOP2 SOC, if you activate the viewer here, you can look at this geometry in 3D. It's a 3D object, although it's rendering pretty flat right now here, or it's a pretty flat 3D object.
Can you zoom out just a tiny bit just to feel like I'm missing something?
Did you connect the constant to the, did you reference the constant material in the geo?
Yeah, in the dragging it into it and then the firm, they said.
The material, yeah.
I somehow lost the chop to avoid.
Oh, okay.
So I think once I put that back in, that makes sense. And if you put chop to, no one, thank you.
Yeah. Perfect. So here you have 3D geometry. What you have here is just pixel data, just colors. Okay, and because I always do that, I'll put a null at the end of this, after the render. Just add a null top. So adding nodes, if it's the same, you can just right click to bring up the upgrade menu, find the null top, and place it. Now if you want to look at what you're doing, and it's a little bit difficult in these tiny viewers, you can always click the display flag, which is the blue flag on the top, to have it display this operator in the background. So you always see what's actually happening in your network. Now one thing that is with this audio file, it has a little bit of a stereo field, but it's still very diagonal. I might want this to blow up a little bit more into a more interesting pattern. And the way to do this, the way you can trick it, is by delaying one of those channels. So for now, middle mouse click onto the output of the audio file in and find the delay chop. And then the delay parameters by default are fairly high. They're like, it's delayed by 1 second, and that's a lot. You don't want to have the second channel delayed by that much. So let's say we just want to delay it by 0.1 second, which is still a lot, but it's okay. The problem that you still have is that you're delaying both channels, but you just want to delay one channel. And this can be done on the common page of these chops, of these chop filters. You always have a scope parameter. And what the scope parameter does, it lets you pick which channels actually to affect. Which channels should this filter actually affect? So here, in this scope, I select channel one, and you can type it in. If you don't want to type it in, if there's also on the end of that parameter, there's this little arrow. If you click it, you see all the channels available. And now you see that these two channels are already, they're not matching up that much anymore as they're doing here. So now take the output of the delay and replace the input of the null one. And you can just go close with your mouse and it's snapping to the input. And you get quite a different image that still seems to follow the music if you listen to the if you listen to the output. Because one channel is still right on the music, so your brain will, you trick your brain enough to follow this whole thing. Now maybe I would like this to be not just this line, but maybe I want to actually make particles out of this and have these particles fly a bit around in all directions. And I can do this by converting this, or by using the line that we created of this XY scope, by using that as the source to a particle system. And to do such that, click on the output of the CHOP2 SOP. And the upgrade dialog comes up with all the SOPs available. And then find the particle SOP. And place down the particle SOP. One note right away about the particle SOP. Those are particles that are calculated on the CPU. And this tends to get quickly very heavy. So use with caution. You cannot do a million particles with this.
Is there another GPU sort of version of it or something? Or you could do that, I guess you'd do that in a shader or something? Or
you would do that in a shader, yeah. Pretty much. We don't have that. Our subs are really old and they're due for rebuild complete to make that possible. We do have in the tools section of the palette, there's a particles GPU component, which gives you a starting point for particle systems. So there it would be possible to build your own with a pre-built component that does it with shaders. So now what we need to do, we need to adjust a couple parameters on this particle sub to get it going more. Like we want to create a lot of particles with every frame, and then probably these particles shouldn't live very long. They probably should die fairly quickly. So in the parameters of the particle sub, if you go into the particles page, you have a life expectancy. And let's set this life expect parameter to 0.1. And then you have a birth rate, and this birth rate is how many particles are created per second. So for our case, we can check how many source points we have. If you middle mouse click onto the CHOP2-1 SOP, you can see that we have, and this should be the same for pretty much all of us, you have something like 735 points. And now you want 735 points every frame. So your birth rate should be 735 times the frame rate, which is 60. And you can just type this in if you don't want to do the math. And I certainly don't. So I just type 735 times 60. And you get a little particle system. Now you can play around a bit and see how far you can drive your system with how many particles until it loses performance. But yeah, you should be a little bit careful with how many particles you're creating there.
Mine doesn't look as noisy. Like, yours looks more so. Mine looks closer to the.
Is it doing the particles?
Oh, you're not doing the particles yet.
Oh.
So you have to.
What did I do then?
The particles.
There we go. I deleted them all.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
And perhaps you can play around with on the force page. You have a whole bunch of different parameters to set external force, wind or turbulence. So, for example, increasing the turbulence to something large. You can give it another look.
A quick question about that. You can put like mathematical expressions then into any numerical thing. Is it how complex can you make those? Because I had made it 735, and then I went times 60, and then I went times 5, and it's all sort of still there,
yep.
Which is kind of neat. So you could, I guess you can just quickly add a multiplier and then get rid of it. And
you can go,
parentheses and
you can use parentheses. It's all Python.
Okay.
So you can use everything that you can do in a one-liner in Python,
oh, wow.
You can do in there, oh, including so loading. There's a TouchDesigner random function, but you can also use the Python random, which you would have to bring in via mod.random because you need to load the module in. Yeah.
Can you get a sign of a parameter?
You could if you would reference a different parameter.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can. You can reference any of the parameters of the node itself, or all the nodes outside the chain or before that node. I'll just show you quickly how this is. The syntax for this is that you type op for op, and open parentheses, and then the path or the name of the node that holds the parameter. Let's say we can choose cam1. So we now have the camera as an object here, as a Python object. And then .par gives you access to all the parameters of the camera. And now I know that tx is the x position of the camera. So now if I enter, I get the x position of the camera here. So if I translate this, now this evaluates to that parameter. And you can do assign with that, or you can't do assign because you have to do a math.sign in Python.
This had a bit of a weird thing because I started it up and I used that media file, but then I just saved my project in another location and my media file is gone.
Yes.
So do we have to keep the media file in the same folder that your TOE file is in?
If you look at the audio file in, it has a full file path. If you organize your project such that all the media files are relative to it, then it would pick up the relative path always, not the full path. But if it's outside that path and you save it somewhere else, it doesn't fix the path for you.
So you have to go back and find it or move it to the... So I'm just wondering because it's kind of odd that it vanished on me.
Yeah, correct. Okay, yeah, it just vanishes. Okay. That's true. Okay, let me reset my camera here. There. Another thing that I perhaps would want to do, and this is always a thing with particle systems, or it's an easy effect that everybody, I think I didn't mention that last time, would be how to create a feedback loop in texture, how to basically draw more and more of the same image and add them together or over them, composite them together. And there is a feedback node in TOPS. And you have to create a loop. Now you cannot, if you create a loop in TouchDesigner with wires, it's going to complain. It doesn't like that. So what you have to do is middle mouse click on the render output of the render one top to create a new branch and find the feedback top. bring up the parameters again. And then you want to composite the feedback and the image together. One easy way of compositing those two together is with an overtop, for example. Now, you could create the overtop and then connect everything, but here's another way of connecting a node in line, putting a node in between the render and the null too, which is if you move your mouse over the wire that connects the two, it turns yellow. And now you can right click and say insert operator, which brings up the operator dialog again. And you can find the overtop, place the overtop, and the overtop requires two inputs. Now, the feedback node has no idea which loop to close, like how to close that loop. It has a parameter called target top, where you need to reference the looping point of your network. So you take the over and drag it onto this target top thing. And now it's drawing on top of each other. Perhaps this is not necessarily what you want, because now you don't see anything anymore. So now inside this feedback loop, you can create, you can add any other operator to change that feedback effect. Mostly, for example, a level top. So right click on the output of the feedback and find the level. And on the level top, you can, for example, on the post page, you can change the opacity. And you should be able to make the old image fade away, or the feedback to fade away, and the new thing to draw over it. Now, one thing about these feedback loops is, since by default all your images are rendering at 8-bit color depths, you come to a point where you will have remainders, like little, if I stop this, might be difficult to see. I just add something to show you what I mean. If I drive the gamma up here, you see that it has a remainder sitting there. That's basically a rounding error. It doesn't round down to zero because it's above a certain threshold. But the way around this would be, if you need to get around this, the way is to change the pixel format of your render top, of your first node here. And you have a vast amount of different pixel formats. So here you could pick a 16-bit float, resetting the feedback, of course. And now you're rendering with 16-bit, which is enough definition for pixel to actually dissolve any remainders that this feedback loop might create. So this will always go back to black if you deal with 16-bit here. You just get from 256 color definitions, you're going straight up to 32,000 something. So it's a much higher range.
Is there a shortcut to hide all of the boxes that you have on screen? Like just temporarily see the background?
Just the background, that's a good idea. No.
No, cause I feel like I did that.
Oh, you hit H.
There we go.
Oh, okay.
Back
I guess that's a quick
yeah.
way.
I guess. You can just move them up, or yeah, that's the quick way. That's
Thanks.
True. That's funny.
So which one does feedback references the over?
Correct.
Top,
yeah. In this example, it gets it gets the image from the overtop. It basically takes the last image.
Right. Okay.
And then overs it. So yeah.
Can you reference the like an internal clock?
Multiple ways to get to the internal clock. which is the timer. No, not the timer. That's not correct. It's the timeline chop. And the timeline chop gives you the current frame, as well as like rate, start end references, BPM, those kind of things. And there's a range of Python expressions that also me.time.frame would give you the current frame. And then there's also appstime.frame, which gives you the frame number since you started TouchDesigner. Since your timeline loops here around 600, if you want to get to an apps frame, you can do that via that. I think, yeah, if you go to the Python help, or if you go to the wiki, it's a whole class that gets you that, yeah. Okay, so one thing you might want to do as well is have control over the feedback level here. And gaining, this might be good to have on a slider or something like that. And TouchDesigner has a whole range of pre-made simple components that are UI interface components. So if you hit tab and go to the comp family, the gray family at the front, then in the center you have various panel, the headings has panels, and you have various of these type components, buttons, containers, fields, lists, and sliders as well. So a field is a text input field, for example. Buttons are pretty self-explanatory. List is something that I don't really want to explain, but it basically you can build long scrollable lists with it. You have, if you want, you can create even interface elements that are your nodes themselves. So if you want to use that stuff, the node viewers as interface elements, then you can do that with the op viewer. But there's also the slider here at the bottom. So pick the slider component. And these components are basically containers, just as the container that we're building stuff in. Last time we created those base components and put stuff in there. This is very similar to a base component, except that it has all these settings for the slider. And if you just for out of interest go into it, then you see that this slider is also built from nodes itself again. Nothing that we really have to look at. But if you want, for example, to have your own graphics as the slider background, then you can do that. You use tops as well. You can use rendered images, and you can reference a background top on the parameters of the slider. But for now, we're just interested on the out. We're just interested in the output of the slider. So you see that there's a little green output on this slider. And if you right click, you can create a null. And you see the value of the slider. Currently it's in the center, so this is 0.5. You can activate the viewer of this component by clicking the little plus sign in the bottom right corner. And you can interact with the slider. If you would want to get MIDI in, then there is a MIDI in chop where you can bring in MIDI data. So now we need to reference this value from the slider to some parameter. And for me, I want to reference, or I want to control this opacity slider, this opacity parameter with my slider that I built here. So I want to export this channel onto the opacity parameter. And if you remember, exporting was this thing where we select the node that we want to export to, so we have up the parameters, the opacity parameter in my case. Then on the node that holds the channel where I want to export from, I click the viewer active flag, the little flag in the right bottom corner. Now when I go with my mouse in it, the channel lights up green, and I can click and drag that channel onto the opacity parameter. And when I let go, I get this drop-down menu where I can select export shop. And the opacity parameter should be green for you after this. And now you're controlling this with your this parameter with the slider that we created. There's a couple more options, and I might just mention this because Python came up. If you take the channel, drop it, and choose, for example, relative chop reference here. That didn't work. Why didn't that work? Here, there we go. What happens is it fills in the Python expression for you. So in a way, you can learn a little bit about how Python works in Touch by doing these kind of references. The what's good about using it in a Python way is if you want to now say times two, for example. It's easier than, or might be quicker than putting a math chop in between here. For clarity, I still like the export method more. I'm more of a, I always, because the expressions sometimes hide stuff, so you don't really know what's going on, why that's happening. With an export, I know, oh, this value definitely comes from this chop.
Directly, no, direct, nothing.
Nothing else, yeah. And so what I might want to do here, for example, would be my range here is 0 to 1. Maybe I want to have a different range. Maybe it shouldn't be 0 to 1 for my opacity, but maybe it should be 0.5 to 1. And I can do this by adding a math chop in between. So right click on the output of this slider, find a math chop. And the easiest way to do this in the math chop is by using the range parameter, where you remap one range to a new range. So my input range, the slider, is 0 to 1. And what I want my range to be is 0.5 to 1. This, of course, also giving you final control now of the opacity. So now I created my great visualization, and I wanted to show to everybody. I want to put it up on a screen, or I don't want to see any of these nodes. And the way to do this is by using a component that's called the window component. I'm just going to double click here, or open up the OpCreate dialog by double clicking or hitting tab, and go to the component family and find the window component. And the window component is in this section that's called Other. The window component basically opens up a new renderer, and in Windows, a new, totally new window, and displays any operator that you give it in the operator parameter. So I want to see the end result here, the null 2. So I reference that in the operator field. And if you look all the way down on these parameters, there's now open as perform window. I'll explain that in a second. And open as separate window. And I'm just going to click open as separate window. And that opens up this little window with a border still. It's a separate window with a border. Not necessarily what I want. I want this to have no borders. So if you look, there's a parameter that's called borders. I can turn that off. If I now click it, I get a window, but it's still too small. It's in the corner there. And now how do I close this window? I close it if you click on it and hit escape, then that will close. So a little bit further up, there's an opening size parameter. And it says automatic from comp top, which means if I middle mouse click on this null top, you can see that the size of this operator is 1280 by 720 pixels. But I want this to go full screen. So what I would choose as the opening size is fill location. And now if I say open as a separate window, I have a full screen view of the whole thing. Now to explain what perform window is. What's happening with as a separate window is still that the interface of TouchDesigner is still drawing in the background. And that takes considerable amount of performance. So you have a lower performance with this interface showing. If you want the, if you're done with your project and you just want to show it on a screen and you don't need access to the network, then you can say open as perform window. And what that does is it pretty much closes down the network editor and just shows the output, and you get maximum performance. There's a couple more parameters here where you can, if you have multiple projectors connected or multiple monitors, to select which monitor to output to actually. One note of advice is that in, not sure how it's on Mac actually, but definitely on Windows, if you have multiple, if you want to display on multiple projectors, then it's better to build yourself a canvas that has all the renderers in, or all the images that you want to show in this one canvas, and then open one big spanning window, then opening three separate windows, because that takes your performance down a little bit, or quite a bit actually. Also, another note, there is a close on escape key parameter here. It's usually advised not to turn this off, because if you turn it off, there's no way of closing this. This combined with always on top kind of shuts you out of your computer. But necessary for some things, not for this.
Kiosks,
exactly, yeah. That's pretty much it. If you're working on high resolution displays or ultra high resolution displays, then there's also a DPI scaling parameter here where you can adjust to either showing it native or scaling to scaling the texture to your monitor. What you also realize now, you're working on, if you're working with a non-commercial version, then the render resolution is limited to 1280 by 720, but the output resolution is not. So you can go full screen and display the image, but the image is stretched, basically. It scales it up. Any questions on this? Checking. Oh, right. Another thing, one more thing here is that we created this slider, and if you go outside of this network, because we created this network in something called Project One, so we're inside a container. If you go outside of this container, you can see that this slider now is available down here in the corner. So you don't see the image currently, but we can certainly display the image here as a background. We'll just go inside and check what the name of this image is. It's null 2. So here we have project 1. And on the look page of project one, you can define the background top. And this notation is like a path notation, Unix path notation, dot meaning go inside, dot slash go inside and check there. So for me, this is null two, this top. And now I have my background image and my slider here. So when I activate the viewer, I now can control this with the slider. And that would be kind of the basis of UI building as well, because now you could add many sliders and fields and can create your own interface.
Do you have a choice of the layout? How do you define the layout on that screen? Is that like on the thumbnail? Is it just the order that you place them down, or is it?
All these containers or the sliders, buttons, etc., they have a layout page themselves where you can position them. And something that I don't really want to go into is also how to build these panels, because you can build kind of like trees with them, where you, if you have 10 sliders, that they get automatically laid out.
Right.
Those kind of things. We do have tutorials on that on the web page, if that becomes of interest. I should point out, let's see. Just want to show you an interface of, scrolling. Our blog is from 1999, it's all HTML on one page. Oh, that's not true. You can actually click and then you get another page. Oh, actually there's an interface here. So this Kinetic Lights installation thing that has where we built an interface for, and so you see you can kind of create interfaces with like lists and parameters and playlist items that can be reordered, and all of this is certainly possible with UI building in Touch, but it's a whole different beast kind of. And
did they build that, or did you guys build that for them?
We built it for them, but all with Touch Design Notes, and then since about 2 years they developed them by themselves. So they took that completely, they took that over and built themselves now. Okay, any other questions? Maybe, yes?
When you're with the window, and I'm noticing that you can select multiple monitors and stuff, how do you define which monitors which sort of thing?
On Windows, and I can only speak for Windows because I forget how it works on Mac. In Windows, the monitor ID is in the order that you lay them out in the what is that called?
The control panel, or?
Yeah, these viewer settings here.
Yeah. Okay.
So display settings.
So the monitors are defined by the operating system, and TouchDesigner knows to go in and just looks at monitor one, whatever Windows or the Mac OS is declared as monitor one.
No, in order actually.
Okay.
The way from left to right, in that order.
Yeah.
There is also, to help with that, there's a monitor dot, which gives you information of all the monitors that are connected. And monitors dot, it's in the pink section. Yeah, that gives you, if you have multiple monitors connected, the whole lowdown on that.
And I assume there's no limit from Touch Designer's perspective in terms of how many monitors?
No, not really. That's an issue of pixels on your video card, pretty much. The biggest thing to date driven from one computer with Touch was 50 something projectors out of one box. But that's
separate outputs.
Three video cards, every output on a video card going to a data path to split into four. And this, so 4 times, 12 times. The window lets you either open as location on a single monitor, on the main monitor, or if you select all monitors, then you can position it as well. Then you have you would specify this with opening size custom, and then specify size and location.
And you said that all monitors, one is the one that tends to have the best results? It's a single window spanning, or
it's if you're spanning across multiple monitors and they're not set up as a mosaic or something like this, then you would choose all monitors and make one big canvas.
Right.
Correct. Yeah, that's the. Otherwise, you get V-sync problems,
right,
and you see tearing and stuff like that.
And with that size, like, you could specify your aspect ratio. So if you had like 2 monitors high by 8 monitors wide, or if you had something inverted, and could you do things that aren't squares, or is it?
No, it's always a texture.
Okay.
It's always a rectangular texture.
XY sort of.
Yeah.
Shape. Okay.
That you would have to output. Yeah. You sometimes do things where you have, because you have a limit, or I think it's still a limit, 16,000 something pixels for texture squared. So if you have to split that onto, I don't know, 10 monitors or something like this, then you place them wildly, basically, depending on how they are then processed on the hardware. Yeah.
Is that, I've read lots about people doing, like, also saying another way around is like creating multiple instances of TouchDesigner that are each running, and then they're talking to each other with like the communicate. I can't remember what it's called, but it's touch.
There's various operators as well in the texture part where you have shared memory, or we use Siphon,
right,
where you can send textures across. Or you use chops where you have touch in, touch outs,
right,
to communicate over the network or over instances. And the same, you can send transforms via components. You have DUTs that you can send across. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So that would be the communication. It's getting problematic if you're running on Quattro cards,
okay,
then you can assign also the GPUs separately per touch instance on a different GPU. Otherwise, they would all run on one GPU in parallel.
Right.
So there might be, you don't have a performance increase necessarily.
Yeah. Yeah.
But what you could do, what people do, is that you have audio processing in one instance,
right,
and do all the rendering in another instance.
I think so, because it only uses one CPU core, doesn't it? So that's the way I think they're talking about economizing, because then you can do something that's heavily computational but not graphical,
yeah,
on one instance, and then you save your one other instance that's for all your GPU related stuff.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. This way you can balance the load a little bit. It's always a little bit the, yeah.
So you can't assign GPUs via GeForce?
Not with a GeForce, no. That's only a GPU affinity, only a Quattro. Not sure if you can still do this, where you can trick a GPU to a GeForce to pretend it's a Quattro, and then everything works way better. But that used to be possible.
They get more expensive, the risk of soldering them. Yeah. Although some of it was almost flashing.
Yeah, invite humor. All right.